Welcome, Overstock CEO, joined by the founder and director of the Newton School and chair and director of Overstock.com, Jonathan Johnson and Allison Abraham.
Wow.
Welcome. I'm eager to introduce to the Silicon Slopes community, Allison Abraham. Allison has been on the board of directors of Overstock for over 20 years. She's helped us grow from a $50 million revenue company to an over $2.5 billion revenue company. We've got a lot to learn from Allison.
Great. Thank you. Very pleased to be here today. It's my first time for Silicon Slopes, so thrilled to be in Utah. Flew in last night, and I love it here.
Allison, tell us, how did you join the board? How did that happen? And then how and when did you become chairman of our board?
Sure. So that's a little of traditional and a little in an Overstock style. So back in 2002, one afternoon, I got a phone call. And it was from a current board member of Overstock who I had worked with a couple years prior. And he said, you know, hey, we need a woman who's got internet experience to join our board because we're looking at going public. You know, are you interested? So I really didn't know anything about Overstock. And, you know, I was kind of flattered. And I thought that was a good opportunity. Explain to me a little bit. And I was said, you know, I'd be glad to think about that. So I thought I was going to have time to do some research and, you know, look at the industry and think a little bit about, you know, would that be a good opportunity for me? And, you know, less than an hour later, the CEO of Overstock called me and said, glad you're joining the board. We've already done all the paperwork. Our first board meeting is Friday. You know, someone will call you to tell you how to join. And, you know, our in-person board meeting is in June, and I need you to fly here to Salt Lake City. So I explained to him that I was 8 months pregnant at the time, and, you know, he just looked on the phone and said, don't worry about it, bring it along, it'll all be fine, you know. And so I had my first call that week for the Overstock board meeting. It was a huge whirlwind. And then I went to my first Overstock meeting on a private plane with a nanny, with the baby that was like 6 weeks old, and you know, that's how things got started. So it was definitely a whirlwind, and you know, really it was for me taking advantage of just an amazing opportunity with Overstock. I think I never dreamed that I would be here 20 years later, and a lot has happened, but you know, it has been a great opportunity, and I was thrilled to just be able to take advantage of that, you know, in an hour, one day out of the blue in March of 2002.
Thank you, Allison. So most of us here in the audience know our companies have a board, and it's kind of a behind the curtain thing. Tell us, what do boards do? What's the responsibility of the board? And particularly, what do you do as chairwoman of our board?
So really, you know, boards are there for technically governance, oversight, help with strategic decisions, but you know, really we're also responsible for choosing the CEO, and that's a very important role of the board. You know, technically we meet many times a year, quarterly for sure, because we are a public company, but we also communicate very frequently about things that are going on within the company. I do talk to Jonathan a lot, to you know, the CEO as a sounding board. And then we help to make decisions, you know, about the company's direction, you know, again, about governance, you know, helping with our employees and really, you know, trying to help the company be successful. It's not an operating role. It's really more of an oversight. And, you know, technically, we also represent all the investors and in making sure that the company, you know, is meeting their needs and why they invested in it.
Thank you for the oversight. We like it at Overstock. Let's move away from the board. You mentioned you're last child was born just before you joined the board. I know you ran into some educational challenges with some of your children. Talk to us about your day job. Talk to us how you balance that with your board role at Overstock, your family. That's a lot of plates to be spinning at once.
It is. So never shortage of things to do for me. And back in 2008, I have three children. My middle son was definitely struggling in school, and it was just too stressful, I think, as many of you know, if you're parents, to see a child struggle. And it was very clear to me pretty quickly that, you know, the public school option was not going to be a good fit for him. So I did look at the different schools in our area. I mean, I live outside Washington, D.C. You'd think it would be a lot of options. I didn't really find anything I liked. So I decided pretty quickly that I was going to build a school myself that would meet his needs, because there were obviously, you know, a lot of children in the world that just don't fit the public school model. I had many people trying to talk me out of that, thought it was a bad idea. Like, I didn't know anything about education. What would I know about a school? You know, no one would come. But, you know, I was dug in pretty deep, and, you know, I was the customer. So I knew how to reach people, how to, you know, put something together that would be great for kids. And lo and behold, you know, 12 years later, I am still running a school. It's very successful, nonprofit. And, you know, we've transformed lives of kids. I've seen kids who have, you know, come to our school at 6 years old and just not performing well, leave being just star students and going on to do much bigger things. So it's been a nice balance with a business of Overstock, being a nonprofit, very impactful, high-touch kind of business that makes you feel like you're doing good in the world. So that's been really fulfilling. But, you know, as I said, I have three kids, I have a family. My family's had a number of health challenges over time. And, you know, I'm not gonna lie, pretty stressful of trying to do all of those things at one time. And of course, you know, fourth down the totem pole is like me. You know, what do you do for yourself? And as I'm sure a lot of you know, with big jobs you have, many cases you come last, and that's no surprise, you know, for me as well. So I think I've been very lucky of the way this is all balanced out. So I can run the Newton School during the day. Most of the Overstock board is on the West Coast, and so Overstock can do a lot of things and later in the day into the evening with me. And then, you know, you balance as well as you can, you know, your family, yourself, and making sure that everybody is doing well. But it's been tough. I'm not gonna lie there.
Thank you for sharing that. And I hope we haven't added too much to that toughness and that stress. How? What advice do you have for people in the audience, particularly women, who want to get on the executive track or more particularly the board track? What can they do to kind of start that?
You know, I think the number one thing for board members is to have experiences. That's what you bring to the board. What have I lived through? What have I done? And that just doesn't mean good, you know, in good times. You know, having been successful of things when things didn't go well, and that you have weathered that and figured out how to manage it, is a really valuable thing to bring to boards. So that experience is very important. And the second piece of advice is to, you know, take some opportunities, jump on some things that you may be a little worried about, or maybe you don't feel you're quite ready for, but, you know, having new opportunities is a great thing. And third is really finding, you know, a mentor is kind of the way to think about it, but really being willing to ask people for help. So I'm not great at asking for people for help. I always feel like that's a sign of weakness. But the reality is, you know, people will help you. If you are performing, you're doing well, you know, people can give you advice, make connections, you know, help with your career. And so finding not just one mentor, but advocates throughout will really be helpful in your career. So I am a big proponent of getting women into more executive ranks on the board. Don't be afraid, take initiative, speak up. You know, that's why you're there.
Speaking of mentors, I've always found anytime I've asked somebody if they would be a mentor, they're flattered. And I think we don't really think about saying, will you be my mentor? But people do.
Yeah.
Allison, our board has changed quite a bit over 20, 21 years. What have you done to help foster diversity on our board, on our management team, within the company?
Yeah, the last couple years, you know, since Jonathan's been CEO, we've made a big effort for diversity at the board level and the company. So we have three new board members that have joined us, and it's really important that they bring lots of different opinions. You know, otherwise you can just stagnate and, you know, do the same thing over and over again. So those three board members had very different experiences. We vetted them very purposefully so that they had different experiences. And I think what's really important about that is then you ask them and listen to them. So you value their opinion, you make sure that they're being heard, you are thoughtful about your interactions and your communications, and that's a lot of what I do as the chairwoman, is make sure that everybody's heard, that we have a diversity of thought and backgrounds, and so that decisions are much more well thought out and just not more of the same. And I think from a management perspective, you know, we are working very hard to have a diverse population. I think the remote work that we're doing is really helping with that. And again, it's, you know, we want to make sure that there is different thoughts and that we're making better decisions about running the business. That's what it's all about. It's not diversity for diversity. It's to help the business run better.
Talking about being able to make better decisions, what do you think have been the toughest or the most important decisions that you've been part of as the Overstock board, and how did the board coalesce around making those decisions?
Yeah. So I can think of two. As I mentioned earlier with the board, the most important thing the board can do is picking the CEO. So, of course, our CEO is next to us.
We're going to have a little performance review in front of all of you.
But, you know, as you may recall, in August of 2019, our former CEO resigned, and we were faced, you know, pretty abruptly with who was going to take in charge. And that was a very delicate situation. Financially, we weren't in great shape. We'd had a lot of turnover, so the business wasn't running necessarily well. We had both a retail business and a very large blockchain portfolio, so you needed a CEO who could think about both of those. So, you know, we met, we talked, we were very thoughtful. We put Jonathan in as our interim CEO to give us just a little bit more time. And what became clear over then the next month was we really needed strong leadership, good stability, you know, thoughtful decision making, and so we made Jonathan the permanent CEO. But that was clearly the biggest decision we made, because the CEO is running the company, you know, is moving us to a strategy of sustained profitable growth and taking market share, and he makes all the senior management hires, and really important. The second decision I think that the board made, you know, over the last 2 years too, that was very helpful to the business is, as I mentioned, we run a retail business. So every day we are out there selling, you know, couches and toasters and sheets, and that's a tough business. We're public, we have a quarterly earnings, we have investors, we have goals we need to meet. And what we had done since 2015 is built up a blockchain portfolio of about 21 companies that were, you know, needed nurturing. They were startups. They were losing money. They were finding their business models. And running those two things at the same time created really undue pressure on the startups, because we were like, oh gosh, it's a quarterly earnings. You know, we need all your numbers. And it was hard for the retail business because, you know, any cash we threw off on the retail business was busy funding, you know, a startup business. So we could have shut it down, we could have sold it off, but instead we created a pretty complex but really good partnership with Pelion. And now Pelion is managing our blockchain. We still can reap some benefits of that because we're investors, but we don't run the day-to-day management. So that was like a win-win for both Overstock, takes that money off our books, we are now profitable. It gives the startups much more of a nurturing environment with less pressure, but it was pretty complicated to get through. It took us at least 6 months to get through that and even longer to close and execute, but it's turned out to be a great partnership, but pretty hard, and the board was extremely involved in all the valuations and the structure and the setup. So, you know, I think that's a great accomplishment for us.
Yeah, thank you. That was a lot of work, and it was a lot of work. Important thing for us to do at the time.
Yes.
Allison, you're from out of state, but you've been coming here for over two decades for Overstock. What's your view of the Utah tech community? Utah is a place to do business. Tell us how you perceive it from someone who's here but not here.
So it is a fantastic place. When I first joined, I was actually super excited that I'd get to come here and go skiing and do all the exciting things here and bring my family. I have yet to do that after 80, 90 trips here. But, you know, really, it's about the people here. Fantastic group. It's always been a big A-plus for us in terms of Overstock. You know, the challenge is that it's got very low unemployment. And now I think a lot of the world has figured out how amazing Salt Lake City is to be in. So, you know, you've got some housing price inflation and things like that, but it is a great place. And I'm thrilled to be coming so often and, you know, proud of everybody in this room that you've been able to establish yourselves as like a tech community. And, you know, we could see that as some of our blockchain companies were right here in Utah. Pelion's right here. We didn't have to look very far to get superstars in tech to help us grow those businesses. So that was really exciting and a great place.
It's great to hear. Allison, you've had a successful career. You've helped me have a more successful career. What are some of the lessons that you've learned along the way that you think people in the audience should know about how to succeed and kind of plan their own careers?
Yeah. So, you know, as I've gotten a little older, a little more experience, I've had some time to reflect on that. And I think for me is, and this is kind of the buzzword at the moment, but really trying to be intentional. So I look back at my career and I wish I had been more intentional in those moments. So, you know, when you take how I joined the Overstock board, that was not intentional. That was a good opportunity, but not intentional. I think staying on the Overstock board was very intentional because there were a number of times where I felt like maybe I should not be doing this. But I really made the decision very thoughtfully that the company, the investors were better off with me on the board than not on the board. So I'm proud of that decision being very intentional. Starting the Newton School was very intentional. But, you know, I think maybe like some of you, I have that tendency to get caught up in the day-to-day. I'm super busy, I'm very productive, I don't get enough done, I work on lists, I cross things off, I'm exhausted at the end of the day, you know, I want to make sure I've accomplished something. But the problem with that is time goes by and you may or may have not accomplished what you set out to do. You are busy, but you may not have, you know, intentionally chose a path and then executed on that path. So I think my advice is to, you know, really think through what you want to do with your career, with your life. You can't ever go backwards. I mean, I wish we could. There's many times I would do-overs, but unfortunately, you don't get to have any do-overs. So I think thinking through your decisions about your career, you know, everything from where you want to live, what industry you want to be in, the kind of people you want to work with, and being thoughtful and very proactive and intentional and making that happen. It is much harder than just being busy every day and doing that, but being more proactive and more deliberate in your thought will be much more fulfilling. And I would encourage all of you to do that.
Allison, thank you. You know, this intentionalness that Allison's talked about, she's helped us bring to Overstock. And I'm a big believer in purposeful discovery. Do things on purpose, but but try new things. I'm glad 20 years ago you tried something new, yep. joined Overstock. We're better because of it. Thank you,
Great.
Allison.
Great. Thank you.